with me. I've been doing videos for a little while now, semi-consistently, anywhere between 1 to 2 videos a month. I started working in the office, so for those of you who are newer here, I transitioned to working in the university setting at the beginning of 2020, and I was in my new job for exactly, almost down to the date, 2 months before we went into remote work. And now, just a little over a year later, technically we started going back a little bit under a year, we've been going back to our offices, back to campus. I do get a bit nervous about it, but it is what it is. You know, it is my job and I have to do what I need to do. But it's been very safe. I'm not meeting in person with any students, things like that, as well as any staff meetings, anything like that. Any professional development is all still happening through Zoom.
So I think
it's just to start getting used to going back. I know that the state is wanting summer A semester to be
partially in person, mainly
really in person, but with social distancing guidelines. And summer B, the state is wanting all state institutions to kind of be
pretty much pre-COVID.
I don't know about masks and face shields, but I know that social distancing caps are not going to be placed on courses anymore. So we'll have to see how that goes. I think they're really playing it by ear and seeing what is happening and if we need to scale back. But yeah, so right now, you know, we start going in
once a month or so
as a rotation to have a couple people available at the office. Then we went about once a week, and now we're kind of really back to full time. But we're still not having any meetings or anything like that. So yeah, it's been interesting. But all of that to say, I really haven't been able to use that morning time for recording videos anymore. I should have taken a little bit better advantage of the time I had home to, you know, get up with FlossTube and making my own videos of FlossTube, but I wasn't stitching for some time, and then I was, and then I was, like, more preoccupied with getting my stitching done, getting back into stitching. So right as I started getting more consistent with my videos, I ended up having to go back, which the commute time is essentially the time I would use to record my videos. So I'll have to figure it out. You know, like, there are certain times that are just going to work out better to do that. Probably maybe some mornings that get a bit of an earlier start, or as is the case that I'm doing this stitch with me. My husband is watching Baby Girl, and Baby Girl requested to see Grandma, so off they went to Grandma's house. So I decided I'm not really ready to do a FlossTube update. I want to get some more stitching done to show, like, kind of finish my current project, which is basically March Madness. So I'm final, this is the third round. I have one more to go, and this is my Bluebeard's Princess Mirabella conversion of a conversion. So I'm using the main conversion by Train C. Jenkins, which can be found on the Nora Corbett Mirabilia Conversions group on Facebook. Sorry, I'm doing my metallic stitching right now, and I just feel like, although it's Petite Treasure Breed and it's fantastic to work with, it does get caught a little bit easier in the in-between fibers. Since this is an even weave and I'm stitching over two, I feel like it's a little easier to go a little less or a thread over to end up with, like, a rectangle, essentially, of 3/2 instead of 2/2. So I have to be sometimes a little bit more careful. But anyway, so she's off. So I'm like, you know what? I want to do a stitch with me. And I've been working on figuring out the logistics. Right now, I really only know how to record a stitch with me when I have something on my Lowry stand, my floor stand. I wanted to sometimes do it stitching in hand. I guess I could do it here and just kind of stitch in hand, and you just will have to not mind possibly seeing my pajama pants or yoga pants or whatever I'm wearing, because you'd be able to see through, which sometimes you can see when I'm ending my thread anyway. I realized in that my last stitch with me, but I figured, you know, most of you are probably stitching anyway, so it's no biggie. But anyway, so I'm using the Main Conversion by Tracy Jenkins, and when I say conversion of a conversion, I've done a few minor changes. I made the skin tone it's not really dark, but it's more tan, closer to my skin tone, so that I can have some of my variety in my mermaids, and I wanted her to match me, and I think the color also goes really well with her colors. And I'm also switching, there's a variegated thread that's basically blue to light blue to white, and it works, obviously, because when I see the picture of her stitching, it looks great, but I found a sort of similar blue, but instead of going light blue to white, it goes lighter blue to purple. So I think that will look cooler, in my opinion. It's already a conversion, so worst case scenario, if I do a few, you know, stitches with it and it's just not working, I'll just take it out and go back to the thread. So basically, it's this one.
And I don't know.
I feel like that's not what I want. Maybe because it kind of is similar to this blue, which was a different variegated, so I don't know if you can see here.
No, you can't see that at all. It's too far.
But basically, the other variegated it uses goes from teal to this
sort of blue right here.
And maybe that's why the person chose it when they were working on the conversion. But I'm going to go with this color, which is Lotus by Mosail. Yes, Mosail. Which is a similar blue, but it goes to this purple color, which I think will really go well with the colors. So I like that. I'm going to do that. But anyway, today I'm focusing on the metallics. I had the two chronics already, and there's a blue and a more tealy, like green-leaning blue. And then this purple is actually a petite treasure braid, because I did not have the purple chronic. And I happen to have this purple for a different project. But anytime, I mean, it's one that I've had for years and I haven't started. So eventually if I do start it, I'll just buy some more. I probably will have a good bit left on the card, so I may not even need to buy another one. But,
yeah, here I am
with that. I'm pretty excited about it. Because after I do these two metallics and that variegated, I'll be pretty much done with the main stitching of the tail.
So, yeah.
But anyway, I'm kind of rambling. I know, it's very random stitch with me. I haven't done these in a while. I need to get back in the flow. Y'all know how it goes. But I'm really very excited. I just realized you can totally see my pattern, but I mean, you can't like see it. So I think it'll be fine. But anyway, I normally stitch just the one thread right off the card. So if you don't know, the treasure braid comes like this on a card, and you can stitch right off the card, and I usually do, but for some reason, it looks really thin to me, so I decided to double over on it for this. I don't think I'll need to do that with the krynek. I feel like the krynek is just a tiny bit thicker. Could just be in my mind. Could be the same size, but I probably will not double over on the krynek, so let's see. This is one of the kryneks here.
Slot that it's in.
Get it out so that I can see.
It feels thicker, but it could just all
be in my mind. You know? Could just be.
Anyway, yeah, so where's this petite treasure braid gonna go next? I'm just gonna drag it over.
From the back. Not gonna end and start it.
So I don't know, I feel like
I guess it is about the same. But I think the Krynek is also a little bit rounder, which
I think helps, and the Petite
Treasure Braid is like more of a flatter thread. But I don't know, I've stitched with it. Granted, this is also 28 count, and last time I used it, I was doing a Mira on 32, so maybe that's why I didn't really notice. So we'll have to see how the Krynek goes. I think if I double over on all the metallics, it's going to end up being too bulky.
So I'll probably just leave
the Krynek with one thread. And if it just looks really weird, then I guess I'll go back and double over. I probably could have just stitched this with one thread and eventually it would have looked good. Especially these areas here because there's so many stitches close together. Here is where I was seeing a lot of fabric showing through, but it was only a few stitches here and there. So I probably should have just stuck with the one thread, but whatever. It is what it is. It is. I'm almost done with the color, at least on her body, for her tail. But I'm looking. I don't think I see it anywhere else on the chart. Oh, okay. I see where there's a little bit more. So there's a little bit more in the old doodad at the top of the border. So we'll see. I might double up on there too, just for consistency's sake. But it might be far away enough from the stitching that like I could just do with the one thread and it'll be fine. We shall see.
But anyway,
I hope you're all doing well. I'm not sure how long this stitch with me is going to be. I think it's only been about 10 minutes and I've rambled about anything and everything. But sometimes those can be the best stitch with me's. So let's see, what else can I talk about? I could have possibly lost a train of thought here and not finished a thought I started earlier too. So there's also that. But yeah, so I'm working on her for March because I put her on my Whip Go board and she is a March draw. So Whip Go, WIPGO, is hosted by Jessie of Jessie Marie Does Stuff. She started it in 2019 kind of on her own and everybody was kind of interested because she mentioned it in her YouTube videos, her Flossy videos, and I remember I was one of the ones who asked, I'm like, hey, what's this Whip Go you keep talking about? Did I miss an activity, a group? And then she kind of explained that no, she kind of created it herself, and because of all the interest, she opened it up to other people to do with her in 2020. And she was so sweet. She was overwhelmed by the amount of people that joined her group, and now it's huge, you know, even bigger. But yeah, she's definitely a staple in the YouTube community, in the Flosstube YouTube community, I would say, in our cross-stitch community. So I think just the fact that she mentioned it in her videos and it seemed to be a really great way to tackle your whips, you know, it really got people interested and they wanted to do it. So yeah, I feel like I should end the thread and start it again, but I don't think I'm going to. I think I'm just gonna stretch it over because there's some stitching right here.
You can see my needle, kind of.
I think I'm just going to stretch it over and keep going. I know I'm being super lazy with the thread. I tend to do that when I know that I have plenty. Watch me run out now, though. Just watch. But anyway, so Whip Go, it looks like a bingo board. It's essentially a bingo board for your whips. Though, I mean, it can kind of be your own thing, you know. There's 24 spaces, so you could technically have 24 different whips on there. You could have a whip multiple times. You could have some new starts on there. If you don't have that many whips, or if you have a certain, you know, certain projects already planned out for the year. So basically, she numbered each square 1 through 25, with 13 being the free space, which ironically enough was called the first, the very first month, January 2021. Usually, we've had one other year experience, but when Jessie did it in 2019, so she's got 2 years of experience, it usually comes up around the middle or end of the year. And this time, our very first month, free space
was drawn.
Some people chose to put a project / goal there. Some people just left it as free. I left it as free because I have some pretty ambitious goals on there. So the two projects I have this month are this one and a petite gold dimensions kit called Butterfly Vignette, and my goal for both of them is a finish. Now these goals are for the year, So ideally you're to work on the projects the month they get called, but the goals are really for the year. So I do want to finish them by the end of the year. It's definitely doable, but I have quite a few finishes on there because my goal is to whip down to at least 20 whips. I don't know if I'll get to 20 this year, but I think if I have 10 to 20 whips, active, finishable whips, because I do have some large full coverages started and my own sort of semi-stitch along that I created for myself, which involves a lot of Mill Hill kits. So I don't really count those in my, like, active whip pile, even though I am technically actively working on them pretty often, because I know that it's going to be years before they're done. So if I count everything, realistically, I'll really have close to 30 whips at all times if I stick to 20, or 20 whips if I stick to 10, but 10 or so of those whips are really large full coverages that are going to take me forever and a day to stitch. So count, but they don't count. So yeah, so the goal for this one is a finish. The other project I'm working on this month is March Madness. There's a few iterations of this out there. I know there's one by the Steel City Stitchers, and I believe that one starts with 16 whips and goes for 5 rounds. I'm participating in the one hosted by Stephanie Kine, Miss Osa Crafty, and her group Stitch from Stash. And she is doing
a starting
roundup of 8 whips with 4 rounds. I am on the final round. I'm doing this project and my Tilt and Craft Sailor Moon, which is
one of those
large full coverages, because I don't know how long it's going to take me to stitch. I mean, I do want to work on it pretty consistently, so I don't think it's going to take me years, but it's going to take me some time. See, there's the pajama pants shop there and somewhat messy floor. I try to clean in here, but I have a 3-year-old and she hangs out in here. It gets messy. Life.
But anyway.
So she was draw for whip though. She's one of the main projects in March Madness. Originally, I kind of felt like I was cheating because I kind of felt like I knew I was going to bring her through to the end. But then EJ actually mentioned, like, why don't you put it up for a poll for Instagram to see which project moves forward in your rounds. And I knew I was going to be working on Bluebeard's Pinch Up anyway because she's a March whip though. And this isn't, I mean.
Granted, March ends next week. But so it's only Monday.
Today is the 22nd, so I mean, I have a week and a half or so, but I mean, it's really not that far off the end of the month here. So I might actually end up doing March Madness all the way through the end of the month with the final project. So right now the goal is about 4 hours for round 3. I already completed that on Sailor Moon. It's 4 hours. I apologize. Round two was 3 hours for me anyway. There was either a stitch count goal or a time goal. I kind of followed the time goal and I kind of didn't. I'm kind of going more by like finish goals. So I'm going to just stitch on Bluebeard's Princess tonight until it's time for me to go to bed. And between what I've worked on her and this, it'll definitely at least be 4 hours. But my goal is to get all the metallic done. I would love to do that. We'll see if that works out. It hopefully will. So we'll see. But yeah, so I'll be putting it up on for vote on Instagram to see. And I mean, I was gonna push Bluebeard's Princess through, but either way, she's ended up being voted on, which I expected anyway, because the other projects just in complexity, and detail, they just don't compare. And this is just really beautiful and eye-catching, and I think that's what she got voted for. But this one is up against my Sailor Moon full coverage piece, and I think that's going to be 50-50-ish.
So we'll see. So I really don't know if
she's going to move forward or not. I hope she does, because I really just want to keep working on her. But I will stick to my March Madness. Lastly, I am participating in Stitch Asia, hosted by Abby of Abby Bella Stitch. Sailor Moon is my piece for that, and I have worked on her, so I've kind of essentially met that goal, because there's no really a goal, it's just work on it throughout the month of March, so, yeah. But yeah.
What else is new?
We're doing nighttime potty training. So she's pretty much
good at during the day now.
Even number one.
Number two.
She's pretty good. She'll tell us when she needs to go. She won't do that if she's overexcited and she's playing. It's like it hasn't clicked for her yet that you feel like you have to go to the bathroom, so you stop and you go, and then you just resume what you were doing before. But in her, I guess, 3-year-old mind, she's like, oh, I gotta stop doing this, I gotta go to the bathroom, and then who knows what's gonna happen after that. So she doesn't want to go if she's, like, really excited. But for the most part, we're good. But nighttime is a whole different ballgame. Thankfully, she's been in a routine of going number two during the day. So really, it was just being number one, pee, whatever you call it. Who knows? We just use the words. I just didn't know what to call it. I'm lost here. The moms know. It's no big deal, really. Anyway, she...
That little goof.
That she is.
Would wake up at
like 5 in the morning, either needing to pee or already wet. But still, like, not having fully peed, like, having started to pee. And come get me, take her to the potty, or let me know that she woke up wet. And then she didn't want to go back to sleep. And I'm just like, baby, this is not going to keep working.
So finally, we're just
decided to just go the, we're going to start taking her when we go to bed. And by we, I mean probably mostly my husband, because I just need to go to bed earlier. I also have a very specific work schedule. And I need to get up early because I have a pretty big commute. So most of the time, he's probably going to be up later than I am. Now, if I am up later, I will take her around midnight or so. And last night was the first night, and it worked out beautifully because she was asleep until I was ready to get her ready for the day. And that was wonderful because I was really starting to feel it. You think you're done so many times with waking up at night with your kiddo. Consistently. I mean, I know there's going to be illnesses, whatever, tummy aches, all that, maybe possibly nightmares when she's a little older, but, you know, baby, of course, feeding, diaper changing, they're on a sleep a few hour schedule. When they officially first sleep through the night, it's only a 5-hour, I believe. They slept 5 hours through before waking up. It's technically considered sleeping through the night when you're first going for that goal, so that's clearly not a full night's sleep anyway. Then there's teething. Then there's potty training. So it's like we thought we were done, and here we are again with another thing that's having us wake up with her at all hours of the night or dawn. So yeah, so that went well, really well last night. So we're gonna keep that up. I think we're still gonna do maybe some nights. We'll do a diaper, and some nights we'll do underwear.
And then we'll transition to
always doing underwear. We do have a little pad on her bed, so, you know, at least if she wets her cover, you know, the little cover, it's not like she's going to wet the whole bed and the mattress and stuff. So that's okay. Yeah, so that's been going well. So anyway, I'm very excited to be doing this stitch with me, and I feel like the dogs are pitter-pattering, which means that they're probably here. So I'll probably have to cut this short. I mean, it's been 24 minutes. That's a pretty decent stitch with me, right? And talk to you guys in the next one. I'm hoping to try and do a one where I'm stitching, okay, in hand, but not in hand, like, with a Q-snap, but holding the Q-snap in my hand and see how that goes. If it's too unsteady, then I might just stick to working on the Lowry stand. I guess I could just put my Q-snap on here, too. I'll just wear some cute pants so that there's some entertaining background for you if you happen to be looking up as I'm stitching. But yeah, I'm looking forward to doing another floss tube, hopefully sometime this week or next week. We'll see when it works out. I show you all my results of March Madness, which project won. If you don't already follow me and you'd like to, please check out Instagram at crafts makeup food.
And I will put the
poll up there probably tonight to see who is going to be the winner. Who's going to go to the final round of March Madness? Bluebeard's Princess or Sailor Moon? No one knows except future me and future you guys.
It barks.
So yeah, I hope you guys are having a good one. I know this was very rambly. I hope that's okay. And I will see you hopefully, you know, I don't know, maybe once a month I can try and do a stitch with me so it's somewhat consistent. But I'll definitely be seeing you in my next floss tube very soon. And I will also bonus be doing a vlog for you on March Madness as well. So be on the lookout for